Welcome to the Thunderbolts podcast for May 27th, 2016. In the previous episode, David Talbott, the director of the Thunderbolts Project, began his discussion of his working relationship with one of the world's leading experts on space plasma, renowned plasma physicist Dr. Anthony Peratt of Los Alamos Laboratories. In the Thunderbolts documentary, Symbols of an Alien Sky, well over a million viewers to date have received a brief introduction to Peratt's extraordinary research into pictographs in the American Southwest, images that match the forms of high-energy plasma instabilities. The implication is that these plasma forms were seen in the sky above ancient man and depicted in rock art around the world. As David explained in our last podcast, when Peratt published his findings, he came under intense pressure for his involvement with the Electric Universe community. Today, in this recorded talk, David adds further to the story of Peratt's contribution and the events that effectively ended his groundbreaking research.
The events leading to the destruction of plasma scientist Tony Peratt's career hold a unique message for us. The story must be told because those complicit in the ending of Peratt's work are still holding in place a profound deception, a cover story to hide misconduct in the sciences. The critical turn came in relation to a seminar our group announced for Portland, Oregon, September 22nd to 24th, 2000. We had made the decision to invite several scientists on the leading edge of innovation, including plasma cosmologist Tony Peratt, astronomer Halton Arp, astronomer Tom Van Flandern, and geologist Robert Schock. But then it happened. First one, then another, then a third speaker notified us that he was unable to attend. Of the speakers I've named here, just one was left, Dr. Tom Van Flandern. I called Tom, whom by good fortune I had gotten to know at an earlier conference in 1994. He informed me that the speaker's canceling had been scared away by threats from a fellow I shall name Resident Troll, whose words made clear that he would personally guarantee the destruction of their careers if they attended. Tom and I agreed that separately we would call the speakers who had canceled and explain the situation to them. I still remember these conversations well, and it was clear that each of our originally named speakers really did prefer to come. The only obstacle was the anxiety instilled by Resident Troll's threats. As it turned out, our conversations were sufficient to persuade all of the speakers to attend, and in surprising ways, the event proved to be a turning point for us. On the Monday following the seminar, we called a private gathering of speakers. The room was filled with inspiration and a sense of raw potential opening in front of us. It was during this meeting that the late astronomer Halton Arp, the leading authority on peculiar galaxies, stated his impression of my own work. "What excites me the most about your presentation is that we are now seeing in remote space the types of formations that you've described in Earth's past." One of the archetypal forms I had discussed at the conference was a global theme often named the Chain of Arrows. This theme is almost always connected to another archetype called the Ladder of Heaven. As the story goes, a great warrior launches arrows into the sky, each embedding itself in the one above, to form a ladder or stairway to the land of the gods. Of course, I'd long been persuaded that the global themes of myth and symbol all related to visible dramas played out in the sky. And it soon became clear to me that the rungs of the ladder could be best understood as a stack of toruses. I'd noted that the toruses themselves appear to have formed out of twisting filaments reaching upward along an axis before dividing into the toroidal stack. What I lacked, however, was anything approaching an adequate explanation for the eye mask form appearing at the base of the configuration. A few glimpses of the implied evolutionary sequence can be seen in the forms carved on rock in the American Southwest. It seems that this revelation stopped Tony in his tracks. "That's the evolution of the plasma instability in the laboratory," he said. So the moment he got home, he asked me to send him the rock art images. and that began a series of exchanges between us as I conveyed to him dozens of rock art images relating to the evolving formation in the ancient sky. It was this exchange that led directly to the story I reported in the first segment of this series. Initially, I sent Tony just the Kayenta pictograph, the image on the right, and at that moment, as he subsequently stated to me, he knew his life had changed. "You can't deny formations carved on stone," he said. The precise correspondence with the laboratory discharge evolution was definitive, and it allowed for no other explanation. In Tony's own words, and I quote again, "Many petroglyphs, apparently recorded several millennia ago, have a plasma discharge or instability counterpart, some on a one-to-one or overlay basis. More striking is that the images recorded on rock are the only images found in extreme energy density experiments. No other morphology types or patterns are observed," he wrote. In particular, Tony noted the tendency of the toruses to acquire a conical form close to the axis, which would give the appearance of a chain of arrows. And he noted also that with the flattening of the toruses, there is a tendency to curl up or down at their outer edges. "This tendency," he said, "is a precise counterpart to the phenomenon recorded in intense electric discharge radiographs." But of course, these traits, quoting Tony again, could not have been known to prehistoric man unless he witnessed the same events in the sky. The effect of these revelations on the electric universe movement was transformative. Soon Tony had a contract for support of his fieldwork, all with a goal to document global rock art and its connection to intensely energetic plasma forms seen in both the laboratory and in space. In the years that followed, with the help of several assistants and collaborators, Tony used GPS to record the fields of view of the ancient artists at the precise locations of thousands of rock art images. By plotting this data on computerized topographical maps, he could calculate where the various forms occurred in the Earth's ancient magnetosphere. Tony then published several peer-reviewed papers from 2004 to 2009, some co-authored with our own colleagues, retired professor of electrical engineering Donald Scott and linguist Rens Vandersloos. Since these remarkable events, I've often marveled at the intellectual movement that exploded in the wake of Tony's contribution, a movement now reaching hundreds of thousands of people seeking to know more. And I've often paused to consider the situation we would have faced if a single inquisitor, the one I've named Resident Troll, had succeeded in his campaign to shut down our seminar in September 2000. The hero of this story is beyond question our good friend and critic, the late astronomer Dr. Tom Van Flandern.